Acts 21, that's where we're going to be today. That's where we're going to start today. Let's go to Acts 21. We're going to be in Acts, the last few chapters of Acts. Over the next several weeks, we're going to look at Paul's life and the end of, well, the story that we have of his journey. We'll pick up here at the end of his third missionary journey and kind of close out the last few chapters of Acts as we're talking about our story. And carrying over from where we ended last week at Easter and having a good story, a God story that we're telling of how who we were before God and how we experienced God and how amazing it is to be in a relationship with Him and what He's been doing in our life now. And that's kind of the key point, that most of the stories that are written on the walls, when you read them, and I encourage you to do that, they're about things that have happened in the past, and which is great, and we should look at what God has done, for sure. We come back to His Word and His truth, what He has done. But I think it's important for us to ask, what is He doing? What is God currently teaching us? What is God currently doing in our life? And to recognize that as long as we're alive and breathing, that He's not done with us. He still has a plan. He still has a purpose. So we're gonna look at our story and what it looks like to have a story. That's continuing, that God is continuing to work through as we get into the series and look at the life of Paul. But before we do that, before we jump into this, I'm gonna ask you guys some questions since we're talking about stories, some statistics that I looked up and get you guys to respond. So this is interactive, so I'm gonna get some real answers from you, all right? Let's see. First off, does anybody know how many hours a day, on average, Americans spend watching television? 3, 4, anybody else? 5, all right, 5 hours and 4 minutes technically is the average. 5 hours, that's 20% of your day, right? Now here's what's really fascinating, this is from the New York Times, this is from 2016, so 5 hours a day on average, a little over 5 hours a day, but the New York Times says that 4.5 of those hours are spent watching TV live, like while it's airing. Now, a lot has probably changed in the last couple of years in people's consumption of Netflix and DVRing and things like that. I mean, that technology existed 2 years ago, but that's not necessarily translated in these numbers. It's fascinating to me that on average, 5 hours a day, that 4.5 of those hours are sitting down and watching it while it's airing. That's on average. All right, so there's low, and then there's the high. All right, so that's a lot. That's a lot of TV. All right, what about books? How many books, new books, are published each year on average in the United States? 1,000? 2,000? 30,000? Anybody else? 200,000, your price is right. You win the thing because it's 300,000, right? The closest without going over. 300,000 new books published every year. Now, looking at the different data, there's about 1 million books published, which is interesting, but that's sometimes reprints and it's self-published. So that's a lot of books. Now, here's what's really crazy. You ready? And I had to check this. I had to double check this because this is pretty amazing. So how many books are purchased each year? Now, this is digital and print. It's not just print books. So how many books are purchased each year in the United States? 315,000. So one of just a little bit more than each book that's published. All right. Now try a little higher. Anybody? Millions? All right, how many millions? 100 million? 10 million? 200 million? All right. 2.5 billion books. With a B. Right? Now, there is like they still like $17 billion in the industry that from purchased books every year, right? So you wonder why they keep printing books. There's money, right? There's money there. That's a lot, right? I had to look it up. I had to make sure. This is from Bowker. That's from UNESCO. So 2.5 billion books sold in the U.S. each year. All right, how many, you ready for this one? How many videos are watched on Facebook every day? We're talking Every day, we're close. I mean, wait, is that right? Yeah, no, 8 billion videos a day. So that translates to 100 million hours of videos watched on Facebook every single day. Oh, that's amazing. And tie that back to so you got 20% of your day is watching TV, and then how much of your day is watching videos on Facebook? All right. All right, here's a good one. This is a good one. All right, check it. All right, see if you know this one. How many screenplays are turned into movies, are actually made into movies each year? How many movies are made each year? Movies are made. So this is small, this is big movie, small movie, TV made for movie. I mean, it's like all kinds of movies, right? So it's like 20,000 movies, all right? 20,000 movies, all right? But check this out. That's 20,000 movies made from over 1 million screenplays that are purchased, okay? You tracking with me? So that means the movie industry buys every year 1 million screenplays, okay? And then from that 1 million screenplays, produce 20,000 movies, okay? Which means that what we get is like the best, and that's really sad, right? That's not, that should be, somebody should do something about that. Yeah, so 20,000 movies produced, 1 million screenplays purchased, and who knows how many screenplays actually written and tried to get purchased, right? It's amazing. Hundreds of billions of dollars every year is spent on telling good stories. Because we love a good story. Why? Why do we invest so much into that entertainment, into the movies and the TVs and the books and the stuff that we consume? Why do these companies continue to invest so much money in producing this stuff for us? Right? Why are we drawn to that? Well, J.R.R. Tolkien has an answer. He talks about how our heart has a natural tendency to be drawn towards this greater good. In fact, he wrote this piece, Mythopoeia, if I'm pronouncing that right, Mythopoeia, that he wrote to C.S. Lewis as a way to try to convince C.S. Lewis, who was at the time in kind of this agnostic atheism, why people desired fantasy stories, why they were always looking for something greater and bigger than themselves. And so he wrote this to C.S. Lewis, and in this he said, "The heart of man is not compound of lies, but draws wisdom from the only wise." Capital wise, he's talking about God. And he's saying that in built into us, in part of our creation, part of our DNA, and part of our nature, we are drawn to the greater good. We are drawn to his greater good. Which is why we don't like watching movies that have that are tragedies, that have sad endings. We long for the movies that even if they make us cry, they make us feel good. That the heroes always win, right? The good guys always win. It always has a happy ending. That's why it always ties up with a nice bow, right? Those are the ones that were like, yes, that was great. That was great. The every Marvel story, right? Every Marvel movie. Every that we like these books that we get to the end and it's like, yes, okay, the guy got the girl and everything is happy and we're drawn to that. If everything that we consumed was tragedy and the bad guys always won, you know, we'd feel depressed, we'd have issues, and it wouldn't connect with us. It wouldn't connect with us because there is this natural desire and tendency to move towards this greater good. And J.R.R. Tolkien's saying that's how we know that there is a God, because that where does it come from? That we're drawn to him. In fact, there's another author who wrote the book Moral Fiction, talking about writing and writing fiction, and he talks about the same thing. Even though he's not looking at it from a Christian standpoint, believer standpoint, he says the art of story follows universal law that draws towards good. And so he sees it, how the stories all move towards this. And how it's all drawn naturally to this good. And J.R.R. Tolkien's making the argument that it's because God is the greatest good. He is the greatest story. And built into the universe is this, we want him. We want to know him. And we talked last week, like we looked at like what's it like to have a conversation and communicate with someone who absolutely doesn't believe. And those people are, they want good. They want to define good. They want to say what things are good, but they want it to be defined on their terms. And they don't know where that good standard comes from. They don't know how to define really what ultimately is good and right. But so they're looking at themselves, and they're putting it on their shoulders and their burden. And the argument that J.R.R. Tolkien believes should be made for the existence of God is the idea that this push towards the good, happy ending, the hope, right? That there is something bigger than ourselves. There is something more out there. Is God calling us home? It is God trying to tell his story to us and through us. And it's a beautiful thing. So we talked last week about how the greatest testament to faith is our testimony of faith. But I think it's important for us to really ask the question, I mentioned it a second ago, is the story, our story, of our story of faith just about, or only about, or more about what God has done, as opposed to what God is doing? Now, we know that sometimes in the books that we read and the movies that we watch, you get to a point to where like it feels like it could end. But then there's a twist, there's a change, something happens, and you turn the page, and you keep watching, and then it's sometimes it's not always great, but then it sometimes builds up to something better and more awesome, and the ending is even more powerful. You're like, man, if it had ended there, I'd have been okay, but it got that much better. Well, that's like Paul's life, because Paul, many times, has planted churches and mentored believers. I mean, half of the New Testament is written from his letters to churches and people that he has discipled. And we look at that and we say, man, this guy has done so much. I mean, Billy Graham just passed away, and we looked at all the amazing things that he did, and he doesn't hold a candle to all that Paul did. But so many times, Paul, he could have hung his hat. He could have retired. And nobody would have blamed him for it. Nobody would have said that he didn't deserve to just, you know, settle down and make tents for his family and friends. But he didn't. He kept going. But what I want us to see is that I think there's a distinctive difference between individuals who see their story as something happening right now and continuing until the end actually comes, and people who kind of settle in and say, I'm good. God did some things, and that's the story I'll share. And I don't need anything else to happen, right? So let's go to Acts 21. We're going to look at Paul, end of his third missionary journey. And we're just going to pick up in verse 7. He is traveling back towards Jerusalem. He's going to stop, make a couple stops. So let's pick up in verse 7. We'll read there. When he had finished the voyage from Tyre, he arrived in Ptolemais, and he greeted the brothers and stayed with them for one day. On the next day, we departed and came to Caesarea. That's Luke who's writing this, so he's with them. And we entered the house of Philip, the evangelist, who was one of the seven, and stayed with him. One of the seven refers back to earlier chapter in Acts 5, I believe, when the apostles, the disciples of Jesus, were looking for help. They called out to the congregation, appoint some people to come and help us take care of the widows, wait on tables. It's where we get the term deacon. It's those who serve, wait on tables. And so he was one of those, the seven, that the church said, hey, these are great, great leaders. And so he was one of the seven. That's what that means. Verse 9. He had four unmarried daughters. That's Philip. He had four unmarried daughters who prophesied. And while we were staying for many days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. And coming to us, he took Paul's belt and bound his own feet and hands and said, thus says the Holy Spirit, this is how the Jews at Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. And when we heard this, we and the people there urged him not to go to Jerusalem. All right, let's stop right there. So this guy shows up, Agabus, and he's a prophet, which means that he is speaking with the gift of the Holy Spirit, the words of God or truth from God, much like the prophets of the Old Testament. and he would speak for God, and he's speaking the truth, and he comes and he takes the belt off of Paul, he binds his feet in his hands, and he says, the person who wears this belt will go to Jerusalem and will be bound just like this. And the people who heard it said, oh, no, no, not Paul. We won't allow that to happen. If this prophet is speaking the truth, we've got to save Paul. We've got to help him. We've got to keep him safe. We got to protect him. And all that sounds really good, right? All that sounds normal and good, right? I mean, that's what you would do, maybe, thinking like, if I knew someone was going to be in danger, if I knew someone was going to go into a situation that could be harmful or hurtful, I'd probably want to step in and say, let's fix this. Let's keep you safe, right? Okay, well, there's a little context that we need to bring into this story. It's important for us to know. And to get that, we got to go back to chapter 20. So Paul, on his way back to Jerusalem, the few days just before, he had stopped and had called all the elders of Ephesus, large city, a population of believers and churches, many churches have been planted. He calls the elders, leaders of the churches together, and he gives like a locker room speech, right? He gathers like a pep talk, right? And I want you to hear what he says, and I want you to think about what we just read, right? Because we're going to set up Paul's response to how the people responded to what the prophet said. So in chapter 20, verse 18, it says, when they came to him, it is the elders from Ephesus. When they came to him, he said to them, you yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia. Now, I'm gonna break this up. I'm not gonna break it up. We're gonna read the whole thing, but I just want you to get in your head, all right? Kind of think like he's a coach, all right? And we're all the players, the elders of Ephesus, they're all the players. So they're sitting around, all right? It's a long journey. Maybe they're sweating, right? Maybe they got their Gatorade, all right? They're just sitting out. Like it's time to. This is the coach's pep talk. This is how we're gonna finish the game. We're gonna finish strong, all right? That's what this is. So we got that picture in our head. They're all sitting around. Doesn't look like that probably, but here's what he says. He says, I lost my place. Here we go. You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews, how I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks of repentance towards God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and affliction await me. But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me. In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And then it says that they knelt down and they prayed with him and they kissed him and hugged him, especially because he said they were never going to see him again. And so Paul is telling this group of elders, he's like, listen, I've worked hard, but now it's on you. I've done so much, and I've tried to be blameless, and you're not going to find any fault in me standing on the gospel. But some of you are going to have to stand up and continue, just as I took the mission and the message of Jesus, continuing his mission. You guys are going to have to continue it as well. And there's going to be people who are going to come and they're going to say ugly things about you. There's going to be wolves that come in and try to destroy. There's probably even going to be some of you. They're going to get the gospel wrong and twist it. And you've got to fight against it. You guys have got to rise up against it. And stay the course and be strong, right? Big pep talk. It's awesome. So he says this. He says, I know the Holy Spirit has called me to go somewhere where affliction and possible imprisonment await me. But I go because the Holy Spirit's called me to go. I know that this is probably the last time I'm going to see you. So instead of staying here with you, and continuing to high five and hug each other and get all excited, I'm leaving you to go do what the Holy Spirit is calling me to do, which might be painful and difficult, and I might die. And I'll never see you again. So I'm giving you this talk so that you guys recognize that it's time for you guys to step up, right? So that's that. Then we go back to 21, and the prophet says, if you go to Jerusalem, they're going to bind you up. And the people say, no, we must protect him. We can't let you go to Jerusalem. And look what Paul says in his answer. Verse 13. Paul answered, what are you doing? Weeping and breaking my heart. For I am ready not only to be imprisoned, but even to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. And this is the verse. And since he would not be persuaded, we ceased and said, let the will of the Lord be done. Now, I think there's a ton of irony in that verse. Since he would not be persuaded, let the will of the Lord be done. Which is it? Is it the will of the Lord or that we persuade him out of it? You tracking with? Is it the will of the Lord that we follow him wherever he says go? Or do we settle in and kind of get comfortable with what he's done and don't ever worry about what he's doing? See, there's a distinctive difference between when Paul says, I am ready, and this group of people that are saying, we want to keep you safe. Now, I've watched people in the church. Let me just kind of bring this back. I've watched people in the church get just absolutely fired up, man. God just radically changed them. Something happens. They're like, man, they want to tell everyone. And they just start talking about it everywhere they go. And then people are like, man, you talk way too much about Jesus. We need to calm it down. Let's bring up football some more. Let's balance it out. Football and Jesus. You can talk about Jesus a little bit. Talk about Jesus on Sunday, maybe in a small group. But you're talking about it all the time. I'm getting worn out. And that's not from people who don't believe. That's from people who are with you at church on Sunday. And it's just like, I'd rather talk about something else. And I think about even me as a parent. Like if my son came to me and said, I feel like God is calling me to do mission work in a country I can't tell you where I'm going because it might be unsafe for me to say, so pray for me because I might not ever see you again. And me as a parent, to say, I'm sorry, I'm putting my foot down, you're not going, right? Because that's what they're doing. They're saying, no, we're going to protect you. There's risk. It's danger. That's not the will of God. Well, the will of God is to settle in, stay with us, be protected, be safe. And Paul uses the phrase, he says, breaking my heart. Which I would do if my son came to me, anyone came to me and said, God's calling me to do this crazy thing, and I know it's probably dangerous, and I know it's going to be tough and difficult, but I have to do it because that's the story that God wants me to tell. And to look that person in the face and say, you're wrong. God would never tell you to risk your life. God would never tell you to do something that's difficult or dangerous. God would never put your life on the line. Stay here and be protected and safe. No. Paul's "I am ready" is where we're supposed to be. And it's difficult and it's challenging. Right? But we settle in to the group that persuades, doesn't take risk and just looks for comfort and says, you know, this is okay. God has done some things, can share the story, I can be happy with it. When God's saying, no, we're just getting started. I'm not done. There's more story to tell. You're still alive, you're still breathing, let's go. Ah, but it's too difficult. It's too much time. It's too much at risk. Yeah, maybe that's the point. So, I think the question, you know, we have to ask ourselves, right? Where is our faith? Are we, like, what is the story that we're trying to tell? I'm ready, or I've been persuaded. I'm ready, God. Whatever's next, let's go. Or I'm good. Thanks for all you've done. I get an email from my son's oldest son's basketball coach. He sends all kinds of crazy basketball things, but in every single email, he asks this question at the very end of the email, and it's supposed to be about. It's supposed to be some kind of this little motivating question to get you to go dribble more and shoot more free throws, you know. And I forward it to my son to make sure he reads it right. But every time I read the question, I can't help but just ignore every basketball connection in this email, and ask that question on a much, much deeper level. He says this. He says, "Are you proud of the work that you've put in today?" And every time I read that question, every time it gets to you, I got one yesterday. Every time the email comes in, am I proud of the work that I put in today? And I think about the story that God's trying to tell through me, and it breaks my heart. Because there are days, weeks, there are often times that I cannot answer yes to that question. That I am not the I am ready. That I am way more the I am the persuaded. That I'm happy with what God has done, and I'm trying to avoid what God is doing. So, are you proud of the work that you've put in? Is that a question that you can ask yourself daily? To remind yourself to be more of the, I am ready, like Paul. He says, even to the point of death, which is crazy. We don't want to think like that. We don't have the kind of persecution in this country that exists in the rest of the world. But we ought to be willing to go wherever God wants us to go, to do whatever God wants us to do, and to be proud every day of the work that we've put in. That means we're ready. Because listen, your past is not the end of your story. And it doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter whether it's good or bad. Your past is not the end of your story. And if the past is where your story stops, you're forgetting that God still wanted to do something now. The story is continuing. And that's the reason why we're going to keep these markers out. We're going to keep writing on these walls. And some of them are going to get covered up, and we keep writing stuff. And you could read a Bible verse tomorrow or today and say, you know what? God has spoke to me in this, and write it And this will all be painted over and covered up. So you may want to write it for yourself just to remind you. Put a note in your phone. Say, God taught me this today. Make a journal. Motivate yourself to be ready, not persuaded. God wants your story to tell his story. He wants to do something now and not just be about what he's done. What he's getting ready to do. Are you ready? Let's pray. Father, my own personal conviction of that question, being proud of the work that I've put in, and knowing that I can't always answer the way I want to. But for everyone in this room, to have not just the story of what you've done, but what you're doing, and to remember that you're not done. You have a plan for us. You have a purpose for us. You've put us in certain people's lives. You've put people around us, us around people, so that we can keep telling your story, so that our story becomes your story. That we are the protagonist and the great story you're trying to tell in our life. And may we not let the distraction of the world and the fight of the enemy, make us think that we're done. May we all be ready. We pray all that in Jesus' name. Amen.